But, you know.
You care about how you look more than I do, I feel like.
Mm-hmm. Well, can you tell?
Let me turn this around on you. When you're when you're just a naturally beautiful person like you, you don't really have to do much.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Yeah.
When you're a fucking zero like me, you got to put work in. Okay?
Because I was asking for a picture of the three of us. Because most of the time we take our little pod pic on Cass's phone, so I don't have a lot. Which, ironically, though, you two are faces. You know how the iPhone has, like, people that, like, show up? Jack is not in there, but you guys are.
Hell yeah.
You have your own little things. But I need a better one because I felt this is where I think I like social media, or maybe this is where I'm a victim of it and really need to watch The Social Dilemma. But I felt like this urge of like doing an appreciation post for the two of you because I've been really feeling the stress like so hard lately being home and having this place to come to and like being with the two of you and like letting me just like think about other things and laugh has saved me.
We're happy to be those people.
So I wanted to do a nice post for you guys.
Well, I still expect
to put it out in the world. Yeah. Well, as soon as Kassem gives me, well, the thing
is
so I asked
Kassem. This is not the post.
I asked Kassem for a picture and he's like, I'll give you one that I know I look good in.
Yeah, because it's such a hit or miss with me.
It is not.
And we could take one today of you hugging us, showing your appreciation.
Mm. I'm so glad that you feel comfortable here. Do you feel like you could fart in front of us?
Not yet.
Okay. Good. That was a test. You passed. And people do ask us that because we're all like close to each other in the pictures. Jamie's been tested a billion times.
Yes.
Kassem's been tested like a bunch.
Well, you guys are in my bubble.
Yeah, we're bubbles.
Yeah, that's it.
You're in my pod.
Robert doesn't go anywhere but here and to my house.
That's right.
I don't.
That's right.
I haven't seen I've seen my parents like twice since the new year, since Christmas.
Two more than me.
Yeah.
Yep.
May God rest their souls.
Speaking of people,
may they rest in peace.
Speaking of people who don't see us, so Jamie, on the cover of our YouTube page, there's a thing and it says like, here's the people who are following you, and it lists them by the most followers they have.
The most relevant.
Right. So I'm like, oh, I know who I'm gonna see right now. And then I start looking and I'm seeing names and it's Shay Tards, who are your buddies following
Thanks,
us.
Thanks, Shay. Thanks,
you know,
for
Urban Gentry, Mary Doodles, That's Good Sports. Now, Shay Tards had like 5 million followers, something crazy. And then I get to down, you know, lower and I see 250,000 followers. I go, there's a name that seems to be missing in those names. We know someone who has millions of followers on YouTube who you'd think would be following.
Wait.
You'd think would be following.
I'm subscribed. No.
Me?
No. You're right. I'm saying you're right. Guess who it is? That's right.
Wait.
Guess who?
You're saying I'm not subscribed to our channel? I'm subscribed. No, this
he
is.
He says no?
No, you're not. You piece of shit.
No, that's not true.
Watch.
I was going to say, I don't have a YouTube channel, so you can't post.
No.
I mean, I probably have seven.
You're in
followers.
The Pajama Pants is in my subscriptions feed every week. What's happening right now is false and baseless.
No, go to the page, dude. He can go to the.
I think it's because
Bryce
I manage the channel too, so it probably puts me in a different.
Stop. Oh, he's always in a different category than everyone else, this guy.
I don't know how to do
what
this.
What a fantasy land.
Yeah, hang on one second.
I don't know how to do this. Exactly.
Okay.
I haven't seen us once.
Case
in
point.
It's
all cos girls with big boobs. Fake looking skin.
A lot of redheads.
Pajama pants. Subscribed.
Yeah, it does say it.
No, you're not, dude.
We have
vindicated.
How many subscribers do we have? Oh, 25,000.
Almost 26,000. Look at that, huh?
Whew,
that was close. So your attempt to throw me under the bus went wrong. Now what do you do?
I think you just push that. I call. I want to recount.
Well, if you are watching us on YouTube, I do find this show to be best listened and watched at the same time. There's a lot that goes on in the YouTube videos that you don't get. Why are you making? Are you making
How
caca
do you do
in
that?
Your?
How do you do that?
Are you making caca?
That's
so
the
funny.
Face
That's what my mom
make.
Called it, caca. Right?
Oh yeah, yeah. That's what Middle Easterns.
Oh really?
It's caca. Big caca.
You're Middle Eastern?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I am here to muddy up the white race. So that's why I'm trying to get wed, have some kids, and just ruin bloodlines. Ruin white bloodlines.
With a redhead, preferably.
Well, it doesn't have to be a redhead, you know? That's how open I am. But God, if it was.
I usually wake up with a song in my head. Just like a minute up and I'm saying, not wow. like some original song. Wow. I'm saying some like.
God, what it's like to live in silence.
Yeah, some song that, you know, a common ditty. But I woke up the other day with a thought in my head, which sometimes, believe it or not, happens. And it was, imagine a Tinder, but for like parents and children. So like if for some reason your parents...
Go on.
If some reason your parents died or they live on the other side of the country or you don't get to see them, you don't talk to them, you don't whatever, you go on this Tinder and you... And at first I was like, this is the dumbest idea ever. And as the day went on, I was like, you know what? Like, I wonder if this would work. Like, people who...
Like, rent a parent?
Right. Like, you match up and it's like, hey, like, just if you want that good morning, son.
Like, it's Christmas. I can't see my parents. Like, who's local that can come over and feel like a mom or dad?
Funny you mentioned that.
This sounds like a Will Ferrell movie or something. Funny.
Yeah, that's what we... Hey...
Pitch it, Cass. We should write this, babe. You know people.
You got it. Consider it made.
Yeah.
I've got a lot of juice in this town.
And then it's like, hey, you know what? You know, my parents died 5 years ago. They didn't, but... my parents died 5 years ago. I missed that thing in my life. How can I get it back? And you go on this Tinder, and you see, like, pictures of old mom and dad, like, with, you know, maybe, like, gardening or doing something sweet, and you're scrolling through, and you're like, wow, I want to be part of that life. What do you think?
Yeah. I think it would be a great movie.
You sound lonely, dude.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
This is what I woke up thinking about, babe.
Well, we talked about on the ride, car ride over here, vlog coming soon. We didn't tape that part. But how I've always been attracted to people with big families. Because I, you know, our family, most of my family is in the Middle East. And so the part that's here is just my parents, my cousin, and my brother. And so I've always, like in high school, always liked to hang out with the kids that had the big families, you know, where the parents were cool. And like, I liked going over to their house. My house wasn't that house, you know? And so part of what I like to look at when potentially dating somebody is like, oh, how's their family vibe? How do they do big Christmases?
Right.
Do they do big Thanksgivings? I feel like that's what I'm trying to create.
Yes.
Did you ever have that thought?
Yeah. I mean, we had a smallish family too, because all my mom's family was, you know, back in Cuba or was in Miami or LA. So didn't live near us. And my dad had two brothers, one that lived far away. So yes, I loved being around people that had big families and would fantasize. And I think that that's why the holidays are so important to me, because I could say I'm doing it for my kids and memories for them, which is true. But also I'm living out a fantasy of my own of having like a huge, you know, Christmas Eve every year where friends and family come, because it's what I always wanted.
I want it so bad. And I'll do anything to get it.
Well, who's lonely now, dude?
Invited.
I know, but I also want to be fucking, too.
They call that projecting or something, dude. What?
I want to be with a big family, but I also want to be fucking one of the members. I don't want to... What I'm saying is I don't want to be...
Just a friend.
Yeah.
Mm, you want a real in.
Like, I'm not going to come over to your house and start fucking Cutter. I'm not. I mean... Has the thought crossed my mind?
I think so.
A couple times.
Yep. You've mentioned how you think he's attractive a couple of times.
Yeah, he's a real good ball player.
Too many times.
That's right. Yeah, anyways, that's something I'm after.
Yeah.
So if you've got a nice big family where you guys do all the things.
Let's add it to that list.
Healthy relationship with your mom and dad. Mm-hmm. Even if you're divorced. Which
ready to muddy up your bloodline.
I'm going to fuck up your lineage, your blood. I'm going to end it. I want to see the look on your father's face when a little brown baby comes out in the operating room. Is that where people have babies? Operating rooms?
If they have a C-section.
Hell yeah, dude. We're going to do a C-section because I don't want anything stretching out that beautiful.
She's going to have a tight one, dude.
Wow.
Yeah.
Speaking of having babies, and we did a podcast, Jamie, you weren't here, where we talked, somehow it came up, Kassem and Gabby having a baby. What features from them would you take to make the perfect baby?
Well, I need Gabby closer. I can't see. I mean, Gabby's hair for sure.
Yeah, she's got that's what she said.
Fantastic hair.
I said my hair,
she's
but that's fine. I'll take
smile.
It.
You have a great smile.
I take her smile, her nose.
Yep.
Her face.
Mm-hmm.
Her shoulders. Her. Mm-hmm. Her butt.
Mm-hmm.
I don't look at it anyways.
Maybe your calves are nice.
No, I have no calves. What I would do is it would her have calves. It would have my personality, yes, and my brain
for sure.
Okay.
Because Gabby's a dim bulb.
Oh God!
Well, she's lost touch with reality, for sure.
No, it'd be cool. I'm always fascinated when you mix cult. You know, she's from like some swampy Asian country. I'm from like the cradle of civilization, the Middle East. I'd love to see what would happen. You know, what sort of, you know, old Jesus DNA baby would come out of that.
You know, it gets tricky when you make a baby with somebody that doesn't look anything like you. Mm. Cutter and I remember, were kind of like, what's our kid gonna look like? Like, yeah, we could be real fucked up here because
you have one of each.
We do. Yeah. And that's crazy that we got that. But we look nothing alike, Cutter and I. You're like, I've had exes where like we look like we could have been in the same family. Yeah. So you could look at us and be like, oh, their kid's going to be so cute because it's like all that vibe.
I think the more different they look, the better the babies.
Our kids turned out pretty cute, so there's something to that.
But
looks exactly like me and one looks exactly like Cutter. True. So we really didn't mix. Our genes were like, nope.
Yeah. It sounded like you guys were doing whippets when you asked that question.
You're like, what's your kids going to look like? Dude, are they gonna get fucked up looking?
Sure,
we were on Ambien. What do you mean?
Yeah, for sure. Ambien. Just doing whippets on Ambien before you had kids. Life was fucking wild.
Speaking of Ambien, I can't wait to watch the Tiger Woods documentary.
Oh, it's great. At least part one.
You watched it?
Yeah.
This kid was good at golf. I need to not be tired so that I can, you know, watch
I don't
it.
Know.
You'll never see it.
And you just made a post today on your Instagram about how, you know, life's just been getting the best of you lately.
Yes.
And I like to say that you are, you know, I don't know how you find time to do anything, really. Mm-hmm. It's crazy.
Well, I also am one of the lucky ones that doesn't have a day job. To think about the parents that have toddlers and kids in Zoom schools that have to be, like, show up for their own daily jobs or as teachers. Do you know what I mean? Like, I'm by no means saying, like, poor me, but I just wanted to just put it out there for other people to be like, because there's been times where I feel like my house is fucking nuts and I'm failing. And the purpose of it with me was putting it out there being like, if you think your house is fucking nuts right now, like mine too. Like, just so you know, there's another house that's like that right now, because I'm the bearer of bad news all the time. No, you can't go anywhere. Now you have to get on your Zoom. Now you can't play video games. No, you can't hit each other. No, you can't do this. Because there's no one else, there's no outlet for anyone, including me. We're all just, you know, tired and angry.
Yeah, we've witnessed a few of those meltdowns. Not from you, but from the kids, you know?
It's I feel for them. They have no, I mean, literally Jack yesterday was like, I just want to go somewhere. And I was like, I'll take you for a drive, man. There's all the parks are roped off. Like, there's nowhere to go. There's nowhere to go.
Yeah. It ties into another conversation me and Rob had on the way over here, how on the opposite of that we are, but how we can observe what's going on with you in your life and be like, damn, wow. You know? Because like 2 days ago, I was telling him, I just put on Ocean's 11 because I was bored.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, oh man, that's great. I think I'll watch the next one. You know, and then I started Ocean's 12 because I didn't have, I just could.
Yeah.
You know? And then I was like, no, I'm going to go to the store and get some, you know, go grocery shopping.
Yeah.
Then I'll come home and guess I'll play a game. You know, like there's a part of me that understands how lucky that is, but I was telling Rabas, I would trade in a lot of that for the big family, as we were talking. I would trade it in, and I think, what'd you say? I don't know how far.
He's like, fuck no.
he really likes his current.
Well, no, I was saying like I don't need the quantity of the freedom I have and like the downtime, but it's the time where I'm like, okay, I need time alone and not getting that.
Yes.
Even if it's just.
Yes, that's what I'm struggling with, is not getting any of that. But you know what was also interesting is.
But you said you can't even like pee.
Mm-mm, no, they come in the bathroom.
You can't poop. Time. Like, it's knocking. It's, hey, what are you? And I've
if
seen.
If I'm not within earshot, my littlest especially is just, he's very attached, which is the age, and it's normal. Bo is the same exact way, but he also is not used to me ever being gone, and he doesn't go anywhere. So it's really tough for him, and he can't articulate anything.
And even if it's as sometimes as simple as like, mommy, I have socks on. And it's like, if you're not acknowledging him saying
he'll
that,
say it 100 times.
He'll just, mommy, I have socks on, mommy. And you've said, I don't even realize he's saying it because he does it all the time. Where me and Kassem are like, he just said he has socks on 47 times.
Well, yes. But
but he's so cute. I'm just saying, I know. You know, it's funny.
But I was saying to somebody yesterday how when I was shooting the pilot, I wake up a lot at night, and when my eyes would open and I would see it was like 5 a.m., I'd be like, oh, you know what? Dope. Everyone's still going to be sleeping for a while. I'm going to do an hour of meditation. And I would do it. And I was like, now I'll wake up and like, yeah, they're sleeping till 7:30 lately, which has been great. But like, I'll wake up at 6:15 and be like, ugh, I'm just going to go back to sleep. And I was like, why is that? And he was like, because you were living your purpose. And so when you're living your purpose, the energy inside your frequency, the energy inside of you is different. Like you're, it's not that I'm procrastinating, but I said to Cutter, I was like, I feel like my vibration is so fucking low right now. And I get it. It's everything seasons. I'm not getting down to myself. I know that I've bounced back from this many times, but I just feel like shit's just dragging right now.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, we love to watch you go through it.
Yeah. You know? Well, I love to have you there watching me. And Cutter and I realize that Cutter and I say to you guys so much. We're like, you guys, this happens all week. Yeah, I feel like we say that to you guys a lot.
Yeah, it's
we like have to make sure that you understand why we're losing our patience so much.
Well, you see, like Cutter will pace into the living room. He'll be like, it's every day, dude. Yeah. you're like, yeah, man.
Bro, where does he get this? Yeah. There's a lot of that. There's a lot of just watching, and then by the end of the night on Sundays, I'm like, man. Part of me is like, I want to leave, but I feel bad for leaving because you've got to do this for the next 7 days
until we see you again. Yeah,
yeah, man.
We're all our energy is built back up to where we're like, oh, look, that's so cute. He said it 47 times. Like, you know,
but you have
you know
a
what
high.
You know what? A big thing for me though. I'm gonna ease up on telling Bo to get off the gaming. Only because there's nothing else for him.
Yeah.
I've become really strict. Like, no more Xbox, done, you're out. And, like, granted, like, he sat and did that comic book with you for, like, an hour the other day. And he was so happy that until I can get him in Texas or wherever we're going where he has other things to do, because he will gladly go do other things, I think I'm going to take that piece of, like, what can I just not be such an annoying stickler about? I think I'm going to just ease off on the gaming.
Jamie-Lynn stickler, dude.
Dang, Dev.
Do we Braddock time?
Yeah.
What a fucking segue.
I don't want to talk about this anymore, or my kids anymore. So let's just talk about Braddock and then move on. Braddock, you know them. We love them. You love them, too. They are the face covers that are most comfortable, breathable, and affordable face masks available, produced right here in the US of A. They're made of premium upcycle t-shirt and jersey material, super soft, eco-friendly. You can machine wash them, reuse them. They're durable. And now when you go to check out their website, BraddockUSA.com, you'll see that they already have great prices. But for a limited time, they're offering additional 20% off with promo code PJPants. Look at the variety of fabrics. You can match them to your different outfits or vibe or vibration.
The new red one is really dope, actually.
Yeah, it's a good red. And again, I don't know why this one reminds me of Bridgerton. Again, that's 20% off your entire order with promo code PJPants at BraddockUSA.com, BraddockUSA.com with promo code PJPants.
Nice job.
Thank you.
I think I'm going to take
Hold on 1 second. Yo, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Perino, tell him, we just did the Braddock ad. You're on pajama pants, babe. Tell him what you were telling me the other day about Braddock.
No, I'm wearing it right now. The only fucking mask for me, man. The most comfortable mask. It's like wearing silk on my face.
And I still can hear you so well.
Seriously, I hated wearing fucking masks. Now, even when they say we're good to go, I'm going to still wear this motherfucker.
I love it.
What a great endorsement from Joe Perino, who's on the set of The Equalizer.
That's right. How's Queen Latifah?
Oh, she's great. She's great. Very down to earth. Very cool. A legend, man. It was so great to meet her and to know that she's not anything but a fantastic person.
All right, well, we love you, babe. We just wanted to get a testimonial from a regular Joe. You know what I mean?
Regular Joe, that's me. Yo, no, seriously, this mask is the best, by far the most comfortable I've ever worn. I will take a lie detector test.
I feel the same way.
All right, we'll set that up.
I'll call you later, babe.
Okay, guys, love you.
See you, Joe.
Bye.
Do you have a Queen Latifah story?
Oh my God!
You should share it.
Dude, what'd she do to you?
I feel like I've already talked way too much.
No, please.
I love hearing you talk.
It used to be a thing. We would go to Miami for New Year's all the time.
You and Queen.
No, it was just a very popular place to go to New Year's, particularly if you lived in the East Coast.
Yeah. It's the best.
Rob and I have done many a New Year's there. And one of these New Year's in particular, my boyfriend and I like broke up that night. And I was... One of the reasons I don't drink is because I'm just not a good drunk in the way that, like, I'm either super funny and happy or I'm crying. Mm. And this one, drunk. Obviously, I was crying. And I was in an elevator crying. And she walked in and she was like, oh, baby girl, what's the matter? And again, I'm wasted. And I was like, Queen Latifah. My friend was with me. I was like, Queen Latifah, you don't understand. And I was so bad, Queen Latifah. She told me, she's like, Jamie, you called her Queen Latifah like 7 times within that elevator ride.
Yeah. Well, that's what are you going to call her? You can't call her Latifah.
I didn't have to say it past the first. I didn't have to say it any time.
It's weird to call somebody just Queen.
Latif.
Yes, but I would have been like, someone being like, Kassem G. Kassem G.
That's how I make my friends and family refer to me.
Is this what you make your girls say when you're making love to them?
I make my mother and father refer. Yeah. How many subscribers did I have? Don't tell me where I'm at now. How many did I have?
Have you lost many?
Sure. Yeah. I lose them every day.
He actually is a subscriber.
I uploaded like 2 or 3 videos in the last 3 years. I think people have earned the right to unsubscribe.
He is actually subscribed to our channel. He's just on the bottom of the list with everyone else.
Yes. That's right. Exactly.
I like how all those people that you named that are subscribed to us are all friends of mine. So it'd be cool if any of you guys' friends would subscribe to the channel too.
I'll tell them.
They're all friends of yours?
All of them. All the ones you named.
That's good sports?
Yep. 100%.
I can't tell if you're joking. I don't feel like you are.
I absolutely... They're all people I've either worked with or made videos with.
Oh, okay. Well, that's everyone on YouTube, right? You're a fucking...
I founded YouTube. A little known fact.
Mm. It's like all
in my basement.
All the guests we've had on were brought by you also. Jamie, if any moment, both of you, any moment of your life, if you could have directed like a film, like a perfect scene... What's the moment in your life where you're like, wow, I would love to have that and be able to watch that? And you could pick the director also.
I'm not following what you're asking.
So think about like a moment that happened in your life in the past that you have a memory of where you're like, wow, I would love to have that
be
produced and directed. Like if somebody actually had cameras in the when it was happening and you had a director who could, like if it was for, I'll give you, so it's easier, like, when me and my grandfather used to take car rides, I wish I had like Scorsese directed one of them, but like he just shot it and did the and figured out a way to like produce it.
Yeah.
Because I would do anything to watch that right now.
Mm. See, I'm like a big movie gal where I like Zemeckis or like Steven Spielberg or Ron Howard, where like I would love the night that I made my Broadway debut with like a montage of like all of my life growing up and doing all of that stuff leading up to like that big moment, because to me that was like a very big, like a dream I had as a little girl that like was made happen. So I would love to see that like cinematically, so I could just have like a little reel.
Yeah. What about you,
on
babe?
Instagram.
I wrote a scene from when I was a kid that I like, nothing ever happened with it, but there was a moment in sixth grade, and I think back of how, if I was watching myself in this moment now, my heart would break for this kid, but also it would be so funny. Mm-hmm. And so it was sixth grade. It was like we had this in the quad area where people ate lunch. There was a mural of the United States painted with all the states, individual states outlined and everything. Mm-hmm. And I remember one of our teachers did an exercise where she asked us to go stand, our whole class, go stand in the state you were born in. And, you know, like all the, most of the kids all were in California. They're all like, you know, shoulder to shoulder in California. There's a couple kids, you know, one was in like Florida, you know, a couple spread out. The camera would like slowly pan. I was in a fucking planter. I was in a bush like 100 feet away because it was the only, it was what I could, I'm like, I'm not on the map.
You're in the sandbox?
Yeah, just, I was born over by this building.
He literally left the school. He left school.
And I never felt more like singled out. And you know, I've only tried to fit in my whole life. Fit in. And then here's this teacher who has this bright idea.
That's what he really says to the girls he's banging, by the way.
Yeah. This teacher has a bright idea to be like, oh, this will be a fun exercise. We'll learn a little bit about the states. And it literally became the most, like, I just spotlight. Didn't know where, you know? Like, she didn't take into account, like, maybe one of these kids wasn't, that didn't cross her mind at all.
There were more eyes on you at that moment than Jamie at her Broadway premiere.
For sure. And then, so I was like, yeah, I was born in Jordan. And because the teacher's like, well, what are you doing over there? What are you doing? And then I looked and there, my friend, wasn't really my friend at the time, but this other kid in my class, Craig Perkins, he wasn't on the mural. And he's like this white kid, you know, looked like he would have grown up in Southern California. And then he was kind of like, I was born in Saudi Arabia. Like, it was like his dad and his mom happened to be working there at the time, and they gave birth to him in Saudi Arabia. And so he was kind of like maybe, I don't know, 10, 15 feet away from me. And then so I was like, oh, cool, you know? Like, and then we became friends, and we got to be really good friends, if you know, in a maybe.
Who
like
would
two.
Direct that? Judd Apatow?
That's a Judd. I was going to say Judd Apatow would really find the moments.
Perfect heart and humor in it. Yes.
You know what would be great is like the camera pans away from the map and you see the other white kid and he's like the awkward kid out and you're like, oh, what about you? And then like he tells his story and then there's a beat and then it starts panning again.
Even further.
And then Kassem G.
100%. Little Kassem. Oh, that's good.
Yeah. That was, you know, my life sprinkled with
it's
a lot of those.
It's crazy how those memories just stick out so hard. It's like they're defining things in your life, right?
Yeah. Poor fucking kid. I remember also that same year. Oh, man. So, you know, people.
Was this in Florida?
No, this was out here. This was in Newbury Park. And the first day of school, everyone, you know, you lay out your clothes the day before, the night before. You're like, you go school clothes shopping. Couple things. I decided to wear a fucking outfit that was all green. I had green jeans, a green turtleneck, Vans, and I just came to school.
A turtleneck?
Oh, my God. This is worse than what you wore to the strip club.
In pure green, dude. Like, I was like Gumby, and I thought I was like, I match. Like, I was like just starting to put together like, oh, matching's important, you know? I came to, and one kid's like, why are you all in green? I was like,
and there were probably different greens too, like, no, which is the worst.
So that kid who said that had like, this was in the 90s where wearing like a long t-shirt was cool, you know?
The skater look
where the sleeves came down to here. And like, it was just cool. And I was like, oh, okay. So I noted what that kid was wearing. Like the next week I borrowed one of my dad's t-shirts and I wore it and it was long. But I didn't know you also had to wear long shorts, so I had short shorts.
You look like Gabby going to get the mail.
I look like Gabby going to get the mail. I looked like I had no goddamn underwear on. Oh, and I was like, God. Oh, man, finally. Finally going to so respect hard. Me. And then I go there, and there's like, dude, are you wearing any pants? I just couldn't
you
fucking win.
You needed to be taking a Hot Topic immediately to
dude,
get the
there
proper
was,
outfit.
This is before Hot Topic.
Oh, my
Your T-shirt
God.
Says, like, the 1961 Jordan Polo
no,
team
it,
or something.
Dude, it was, like, an insurance company or something. Like, the cool kids had, like, I remember one kid had, like,
You need to write a movie on a baby Kassem.
Totally. I actually
you need to
have,
do a
I
movie.
Have, like, a thing that we wrote.
It no was, one steal this.
No.
This is going to be a great movie. And I want to play one of your teachers.
Yeah, dude. Did I ever just tell you the story of how I fucked one of my teachers, Jamie?
Gotta go there.
No, there was no, but I did get a lot of boners for my teachers. I had one teacher who would just buttons, you know, and then she had big boobs and she'd always bend me over to, you know, everyone has one of those, but I really. Mm-hmm. I latched on mm-hmm. to breasts as a yeah. young boy.
The Spanish teacher was
so yeah, a lot of those moments. A lot of those
moments.
Why could
be your Spanish teacher?
Mm-hmm. Give us a little span, Emily.
They called me Julio. That,
no, why?
That's another thing. In Spanish class, everyone got the Spanish version of their name.
¿Dónde
by the
está
time, by the
biblioteca?
Time, and as soon as she got to me, she was like, "We'll just call you Julio." So I spent all year
That's
being
right.
called
everyone
Julio.
Got
yeah,
their
Matt,
Spanish
Mateo,
name.
Fucking right. Everyone was just
She's
easy
like,
peasy.
Roberto. Oh my God, this movie is gonna be gold. You have so many moments
on the roll sheet. Every first day of school was fucking torture because that was the first time, you know, they would see my name mm-hmm. on the roll sheet, mm-hmm. and so I had a every time they would start going through the alphabets and they would get to the F's. And then every teacher would take a longer breath. They would go, they'd say like, you know, like Gwen Franklin. They'd do that. They'd do that. And then I'd go, that's me. And then they'd be like, oh, how do you say this? I'm like, Gariba, Kassem Gariba. And there'd always be a couple people snickering. Like,
oh
that's
my
me.
God, please, man.
Every
this
time.
Awesome.
Every first day of school, oh I got the worst anxiety because I, and you had to do that 3 or 6 times, depending on if you had totally. That kind of schedule, a day for the first.
That could be a great montage.
Oh, just
oh my
unreal,
God.
Dude.
I can't wait. This is going
to
be amazing.
So that's why I did drugs from like 11 to 14.
You did?
Oh, yeah. I smoked cigarettes, weed, I drank.
Wow, such a badass.
So fucking badass, dude.
The other day we were talking, don't you also have a last name that starts with a Q?
No, my first name on my...
Yeah, we ran into this problem at the bank.
Yeah.
It's depending on what form of paperwork you're looking at of mine, my first name's either spelled with a K or a Q. On my license, it's a Q. On my Social Security, it's a K. But it presents all kinds of issues because... Immigrating, you know, you have to like take your name from what was only spelled as like a squiggle and turn it into like a, you know, an English name. And my name can be spelled Kassem, which is how I spell it, or it could be spelled Kassim or Kassem. Mm-hmm. But I think because my dad... Somebody told him, like, you can't have a Q without a U in the English language, so they just went with a K. But it didn't get, you know, it was only a K on certain forms. This is super good pod, by the way, but certain forms of...
Yeah, I actually think I fell asleep for a minute.
Yeah.
The title of the movie should be Kassem with a Q. But, like, you spell it with a K, so it's a Kassem with a Q.
Yeah, so great. That's a great idea.
Thanks. I'll take a small percentage.
Yeah, yeah. So there's just
a
lot
it,
of little
will
things.
Will you make your return to acting for this movie? Come on.
Well, you know, Kassem like likes to make me look horrible all the time, so he would probably make me play the worst, like
the
biggest
dad.
Villain.
Yeah,
yeah,
just be yourself.
See?
Who has to like square off with Kassem's dad in the movie in a scene.
Oh, hell. All right. I'm down. Yeah.
Yeah, you'd be the kid that beat the shit out of me on the basketball court because you were playing hockey and you wanted full court and I was trying to play basketball on
No, but
on
Jamie's
half
saying
court.
I play the father now because I'm 35 years old.
No, you great thing about you is that you don't age.
True.
You could still play a kid.
Some kid beat the shit out of me with like a hockey stick.
That has a full beard in the sixth grade.
I should do, you know how they have the beginning of like the, when you're auditioning for stuff and it's like, hey, I'm Rob. My age range is 6 to 45.
For sure.
Totally.
Yeah. Yep.
Well, I feel really accomplished because I feel like we really, now you don't have to watch another Ocean's movie. You can start writing your script.
Yeah.
My
we'll turn that into a very sad movie.
The reason I asked about the queue is because I remember when I made my like confirmation or whatever. What's the one where you take? Yeah, confirmation, and you have to take a confirmation name. So when you take your confirmation name, they give you like a robe. Man, this is so like, I'm like, wow, I was wearing this robe and stuff. But I had this robe, and then they give you these letters, and on the side of your, like whatever that's called, like the collar. What is this part? When you have like a suit jacket, lapel, on the lapel, you take the letters and you iron them on. And it has your name there. So when they come up and the guy says your name, he looks at the thing, he says it. And I remember sitting there and getting the sheet and like it was like A, B, 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 all the way down. And there's like a Q. And you're like, who the fuck? Who's, because you get to choose your name, you know? And it's like, what it, and me and my family were joking around. Like, someone's like, yeah, my name is, my confirmation name is Quincy Q, man. Like, you know, just yeah. Like, who takes. Who would ever need a Q for their confirmation name? And then,
yeah,
how life comes full
circle.
We're
out there.
I got to meet my boy,
Kassem.
Yeah.
When people talk to me, when I've been doing other podcasts for this, like they're like, oh my God, you and Jamie are great and I love Kassem. Like they always, yeah. there is that thing where they're always like, or some people even say it confidently and say
yeah,
it just
no,
totally.
That's my mom. So my mom has this Cuban accent, so she says things wrong all the time. And she called you Kassem for a long time. But yeah. Like very proud that she could like pronounce your name.
Well,
as if she knew how to pronounce
There's
your
a
name.
Lot of different ways, yeah. There, people like to like so confidently say my name
yes.
wrong, you know? It's one of my favorite versions. Because I'd say if somebody said my name or I met somebody, let's say 10,000 times in my life, and they said my name back to me, 9,900 of them have all been incorrect,
yeah.
You know? But also, it could be whatever.
Right.
There's really no, like the way I say it, they wouldn't say it in the Middle East. It's just like my Anglo version. So I love the people that are confidently
so confident.
Wrong. It's like, thank you, you know? Mm-hmm. Even though you're off the mark here, I appreciate I really, so tell your mother I appreciate it.
Oh yeah. Kassem. How is Kassem?
Yeah. I was actually thinking maybe Apatow too for my, because I was going back and forth between two, and I'm just like, Scorsese, like me and my grandpa would take hour-long car rides out to like Queens or whatever this, and it was just, I wish I could see the conversation that we, and the shit that he would say was
yeah.
just so, like, it was always like, what? Like, and he would just, like the car was moving forward, so was he. Like, it was just, yeah, uh-huh. I remember one time we got, somebody like cut us off, and this is when I was, you know, I was nuts, but somebody like cut us off, or he cut them off. I think he cut them off, and then they pulled up side next to us, and they're like, oh, like, what's your problem, man? You know, to him. And the guy's sitting in the driver's seat of his car yelling at him, and my grandpa just looks at him like 75 years old, whatever he is. He looks over, he goes, oh, sit down. And I just remember, like, I was like, and in my head, I'm getting amped up, like, oh no, I'm gonna have to fight this guy for my grandpa, and I really don't want to.
Yes.
And I remember the guy, like, he was like, oh, sit down. The guy was like he just totally disarmed the guy, because the guy was like, what? Like, didn't
right.
understand.
Yeah.
It was, and just to see, like, how it was Scorsese to do yeah. the shit that my grandpa would say. I talked about when we went to the restaurant. Did I ever tell that story with the two maitre d's?
It's hard to tell what we've talked about
right.
on or off the pod, but I mean, I can never get tired of hearing about your grandpa.
So I invested in a restaurant in New York that was like a nightclub and a restaurant. So there would always be like a ton of pretty girls there because it was attached to the nightclub. So there would always be girls walking in, or the girls who worked there were very pretty. So when it opened, I took my grandpa there and my family, and we had dinner or whatever. So, you know, a month later is Thanksgiving. And we're going to this steakhouse, and we walk into the steakhouse, and like I hold the door for my grandpa, and I know, like, oh, I'm gonna make sure I get to the maitre d's to talk to them, because he'll just, it won't go smoothly, you know? So after I hold the door for everyone, I run up front, and I'm like, okay, I'm like, yeah, two for, or whatever, however many, you know, six for Eiler and my grandfather. There's two like pretty girls working the stand. And it's a holiday, so they're all dressed up in black dresses and makeup this. And my grandfather looks at them, looks at me, and he goes, "Hey, these two ain't as pretty as the girls at your place, huh?" And I was, it was like, you know, that vibe of like, oh, we're all shuffling in. Everything's going to be so like, no, we're going to have dinner right now. And just he hits with that. And I go, I was like, "Pop." And he goes, "What?" And he looks at the two of them. He goes, "You're fine." He goes, "You're just," and he just starts explaining himself like, "They're not as pretty as the girls who worked at the last restaurant we went to." And I was fucking mortified. I remember being like, I was like, "I'm so sorry." And they were kind of like trying to be sweet. And the problem was, this sounds fucked up, but I think if they were like ugly girls, it wouldn't have been a big deal. But it was the fact that like they were pretty girls.
Yeah. And he's, not pretty enough.
Yeah, he's being like, "Hey, you know, downtown, there's way prettier."
On that night, two eating disorders were birthed.
And then they're like, you know, they grab the menu, they have the menu, and they're like, "Okay, right this way." Like, and you have to follow them through the restaurant. And I'm like, I can't believe.
Oh my God.
They spent the next 2 hours in the mirror in the bathroom.
At the same dinner, after we ate the steak, and like they put the sugar packets on the table for dessert or whatever, and it's in like a little tin, all the sugar packets. We just had steak. My grandfather reaches in, he grabs the sugar in the raw, like that brown sugar pack. He folds it and he starts picking things out of his teeth. And we're all sitting there and we're used to this because this is shit he always did. But the next part I was not, which was he took the pack and put it back in.
Of course. There's still perfectly good sugar in there.
Imagine being the next person that wants their sugar in the raw with their after dinner coffee.
I was like, "Pop, what the fuck are you doing?" And he's like, "It's whatever." Another great thing with my grandpa was my sister walked in on him brushing his teeth with the hand soap. And my sister was like, "Pop, what are you doing? That's hand soap." And he just looked at her and he went, "It's all the same."
Oh my God.
It's so... So I would love to have fucking Scorsese have moments from my grandpa where you're
You'll write that script too then.
But when I was thinking about the comedy one, it was like when you said Judd Apatow, the other one I was thinking of, maybe the hardest I've ever laughed in my life was, so we used to go to that club Suede. And outside of, on the corner of Suede was Papaya, which is the hot dog place. And if Suede closed at, you know, 4:30, I would leave at 3:45. And they would let me work there. And I'd go behind the counter and everyone leaving, like all my friends, people, I know everything. I would just be serving hot dogs nonstop. And it was so, I don't know why I loved it so much. And I remember one night we all were standing outside of Papaya. It has to be, you know, 4:30 in the morning and everyone's eating and that drunk eating where people are just devouring food. And we're all sitting around, everyone's hammered. And there were two people still inside. Because they were getting cheese fries. And I guess for some reason, like, that took longer. Everybody else just got a hot dog. And the first one, Heather, comes walking out. And everybody's just devouring food. And she goes, there's, like, a train station steps. And she goes to take a step down to go sit on the step. And she, her slips. She goes up. She grabs, like, the cheese fries into, like, here. And it's, like, the nacho cheese on top. Melts.
Oh, it's hot.
Yeah, but she's wearing, it's winter, so she has a coat on, but it's like clear, like yellow smear going down her whole thing. But she falls down the stairs, like fully falls down the stairs. We laughed so hard because she stood up, looked at the cheese fries, and went to walk right back in. And we knew, we're like, she's going to
get more cheese
to tell them. And she's covering cheese. So we're laughing so, I'm talking like, real. The second person who was also getting cheese fries comes out and is like, "What's so funny? Why are all you guys laughing?" We're laughing so hard we can't tell him what happened. He takes a step to go sit in the same spot and the same exact thing. Just giant slip, grabs the cheese fries, goes away. When I say the next 15, like we didn't eat the food that we all had for 15 minutes, we're just fucking bright red and crying
nothing
in tears.
Better.
And it was the next day waking up and like when you say you wake up with that good energy.
Yeah.
And it was just instantly to the phone and it was like, "Yo, can you believe what happened last night?" And we were fucking, if I had that, but the thing is directed, I don't like, if that was in a movie, it's not as good as it happening in real life.
Yes.
You know?
Yes. Yes,
it's just hard to believe. That's what made that so funny is that it just wouldn't ever happen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he's like, hey, what, like you see
right, he would feel like, come on.
Yeah, yeah.
Grabbing
yeah.
that first fry and he's like, what are you guys laughing at? And right. then just, yeah. whoop, oh my God, we laughed so fucking hard,
that's
man.
That's great.
You going for an email, babe?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm going to go some emails.
Nothing gets by me, babe.
Look, if you guys want to send us an email, it's askpajamapants@gmail.com. We respond to all kinds of stuff, advice.
We don't really do a screening.
Emails to date Rob, you know?
Nope.
If you're going to do it, make sure you send a photo, okay? Tired of this no-name stuff or no-face stuff?
This yeah. is creepy. Come on, don't...
No mystery. Get to it. We
he doesn't
got
want
time.
It, by the way. He doesn't need it, and he doesn't want it. But if you are, just send a photo.
No, listen, I want to date somebody, but I feel like it's creepy to be like, hey, send your picture into Rob to look you over.
So you
it's,
make us say it.
It's yeah, no, but it's just weird.
He's not making anyone say it. We're saying it.
I'm kidding.
Yeah, yeah. Ask for JamFans at Gmail.
This what is from debacle. Isaac.
How do I make myself more attractive? This is from Isaac.
Oh, gosh. Mm.
Hi, Kassem, Jamie, and Rob. I'm a massive fan of your podcast. It never fails to entertain. Thank you all for your hard work. I'd like some advice from the three of you on a topic that I believe would be very relevant for all your male listeners. My question is, how do I become more physically attractive? Or how do I become a more physically attractive man? I do not think I'm particularly ugly, but I also wouldn't say I'm handsome. I feel like this is directed right at me. I think I have a really great personality, but it isn't enough to gain attraction from women at parties, clubs, etc. So do you guys have any tips on how to further sex appeal from girls? Many thanks. Looking forward to next week's episode as always, Isaac. I got this.
Go ahead.
Whoa.
I just got shut.
Look, I don't say this to be a sad sack or anything. I just know my place in the world, okay? I've asked, you know, I remember doing a YouTube video where I asked 100 people out of 10 where I landed. Now, this is before I worked out, before my grays kicked in. Mm. I'm aging like a fine wine.
Most men do.
But I'd say there's a couple things you can do besides having a good personality. And this is stuff that I've only recently learned in the last few years, okay? I can't understate the importance of exercise and working out enough.
So you feel good.
What happens is it's a twofold benefit. You feel better about yourself. Mm-hmm. You have a confidence. It's in your shoulders,
yes.
Okay? Now, I still walk with a hunch in my back, but there's a little bit of
you
a more of an upright.
Build.
But also you do people will notice, and that sort of thing. You've got to, and I think I said this in the last pod, you've got to do you got to do everything you can to, you know, maximize your attractiveness. And I'd say if your personality is top notch, if your appearance is the only thing that you feel like is holding you back, work on the stuff that you can work on, but the confidence is the part that carries you through it all. Even if you don't gain muscle, you don't look that, you don't have a six pack, if you walk around like you have a six pack, or if you get that BRBDE, big dick energy, that's the stuff that people notice.
Yes, it's they pick up on how you're feeling about yourself.
What do you notice?
I think I notice energy. So I think that if you, instead of focusing on like what you can do for yourself, I would say focus more on like the good things about yourself. So you say you have a good personality. So like, you know, I would like you to do an exercise, like write things down that you like about yourself or that people that you know and love like about you, and like celebrate those and enhance those. And yes, obviously taking care of our bodies and like the food that you eat and exercising makes you feel better about yourself. And then people kind of pick up on that. Like, what's different?
Yeah.
So I would just say like work on you feeling good, and then that's attractive.
Mm-hmm.
And also instead of, I think a lot of guys like approach girls in the whole like, oh my God, I like this girl, I hope she likes me.
Yeah.
Like that's the worst energy
to
have. You want to have like, there's a thing when you go to audition for something that helps a lot, people say, is like when you go into an audition, act like you already have the role.
Mm-hmm.
Like the role is yours. So it's like when you approach a girl, there's different things to think about, but one is like, you know, maybe this girl, maybe I would make this girl's life better. Or like, maybe we would think about like, wow, you know what? Maybe we could have really great times together instead of
Or oh, I man. Wonder if this person is right for me.
Right,
not
exactly.
Not if you're right for them. Like, I'm wondering, I wonder if I actually like this person.
Right, or if you really need the confidence. It's also like, you could approach a girl with the thought of like, you know, I know something you don't know.
Ooh.
Mm. Mm.
Yeah.
I like that.
That's what I sometimes, when I look at a girl, it's like, I think like, you know, I know something that you, and it doesn't even have to be
and
a
it
thing.
It might be that I haven't pooped in 3 days, but you don't know that.
Yeah. You said you have a poop story.
I don't have a poop story. I had a poop question, but I think we can hold it.
Jamie. Whoa. Nice. There she is, folks. Princess of comedy. The princess you heard of... it.
Queen Latifah.
No, I got, it was just a question because I know that you wake up, you set your alarm in accordance to where you have to be at, or what you have to do at a certain point that day so that you allot yourself enough hours in the day to poop before you have to leave the house.
Yes.
Yeah.
So what if you have like a 7 a.m. flight?
I just want to say, this might be the first time someone's asked me a question on this podcast. And thank you, Jamie. It's only taken a year and a half.
I just needed to get to know you a bit.
Yeah, you guys are sick of hearing me talk on Sundays. I wake up 2 hours before, but usually if I have a flight, I don't sleep the night before so that I could sleep on the plane no matter where I'm going. But if it's something else, yeah, if it's...
Like what if you had a call at 7 a.m. call time for work?
Yeah. Well, if we had to be here at 7 a.m., I'd wake up 2 hours early.
You would wake up at 5 a.m. just to go poo-poo.
I wake up.
What if you couldn't poop? What would you do?
That's happened rarely. And you just, instead of sitting here thinking about, wow, how much fun we could have, it's like, man, I hope this poop doesn't
hit me.
There's
a dark cloud that hangs over.
You don't like to poop anywhere but your home.
Correct. I really almost
won't. You've
never
pooped at my house.
No. No way. I haven't pooped somewhere outside of my home in.
Well, because of Corona.
4 years. No. Way before Corona. Yeah, anywhere. Like if I was at a casino playing poker and I had to poop, I'd leave.
You'd be like, hold my chips, be back in a bit.
Yeah, or I'd pick them up and be like, all right, I got to go, whatever.
Oh. I didn't shit for a whole week in sixth grade sleepaway camp.
So much happened to you in sixth grade.
This is all part of the movie. It's just
Gosh,
1 year of his life.
It is.
Yeah.
You know what happened is-
Stop giving away your material.
This is all written down. This is all written down somewhere.
Yeah, copy written down.
Shitting is, it's always been a weird thing for me too. I hate shitting. Anywhere else.
Because you like to take your time?
I take my time. I feel like there's a certain like pleasantness
it's
I like to create
for
myself.
For
I turn on the bathroom heater in my guest bathroom and
there's
I let it
heater in
I let it heat up. It's one of those
oh, that turns red?
No, but it's similar.
Like they have in like Holiday Inns?
Yeah, it's like kind of ugly plastic. Yeah, it's like off-white, almost yellowish plastic. Yeah, I got to get a new one. I get that heater going for 15 minutes even before I step in, you know, and then I go in and then I take the robe off, I disrobe.
Wow.
And then I sit on the toilet, mostly naked, and then I go on Reddit and I search for, I gotta be comfortable. If I'm at your house, I get it, dude. It's just like kids are running around, anything can happen.
Yeah.
Anything can happen. And when my butthole is like doing the motion, I don't know. You can see this at home, but anytime your butthole is opening and closing like that, you're vulnerable. There's predators are out circling. You've got to control the situation.
Who hurt you, dude?
That doctor.
Yeah,
the doctor
that's
from
right.
When I was a kid.
Sixth grade. Wow, that's Shit. What it's just gonna be called. That time in sixth grade.
Yeah,
I think there's somebody mentions it in this email actually.
The doctor?
About the doctor. Pajama Pants podcast question. Hey, Kassem, Rob, Jamie, and Gabby, plus or minus guest if you have one. Well, we don't today. Hope you're all having a great day. I'm a listener over from the UK. Used to watch Kassem G all the time when I was a teenager. The California on Ask Kassem Maker Studios days were great. Talking of Ask Kassem, how is John fucking not doing? John is great. He's a father now, so we rarely see him. You have interviewed a lot of hot girls, and a lot of them would flirt back with you. Maybe the wolf shirt and creep vibes was their thing. I've always wondered, did things ever go beyond the interview, or did you keep it strictly professional? I tried to keep it as professional as possible. Definitely, I never. Mostly, probably not. I never did it. I never did. I'm glad I found the podcast when trying to see if you were posting anything again. I get it. I would do the same if I sold my company to Disney. cool. I have been enjoying the podcast. I think you all have great chemistry and the dynamic is really entertaining. I definitely need to watch Sopranos. Yep, there you go. You're welcome. I got you another view.
You did.
I've noticed the podcast seems to have actors or Sopranos theme to it. Is this by design or are there plans to bring some OG YouTubers on the podcast too? Actually, I would think we don't have a theme that's Sopranos. Now,
maybe in the beginning we had a lot of Sopranos cast members.
Yeah,
but those just happen to be our friends. Yeah, also.
They're just friends, and we've had YouTube people on too.
Give the people what they wanted, you know.
I was looking at Jamie's Wikipedia and didn't realize you were the girl from the Jizz in My Pants music video.
I am.
I didn't know that.
You didn't?
No.
What is that?
It's like the, if you look up my name, it's Sopranos and then Jizz in My Pants.
Really?
It's like my second biggest claim.
And that has nothing to do with the video.
It's the biggest Lonely Island music video, I feel like, right?
It was so much fun.
Justin Timberlake?
Yeah.
And
I did my stuff with Jorma. Yeah.
Yeah. That's great. That video was legendary and you nailed the bagging groceries seductively yet with look of disgust face.
Oh, thank you.
How did you get involved in that role? Did you know much of the song before?
You
want
to hear something funny? I was at, Jim's wedding in New York.
The best.
And I got a call from my agent being like, the Lonely Island boys are shooting this video. They don't know if it actually ever air on SNL cause it's a little risky, but it just was post Dick in a Box.
Mm-hmm.
So they were gonna, he was like, it's like Dick in a Box. It'll be just a couple hours of your time cause you're in New York. Will you do it tomorrow? And I was like, I was always game for anything. Mm-hmm. So I'd be like, yeah, that sounds fun. And they literally explained it to me when I got there.
Oh, it's awesome.
Yeah. And sent me like an MP3 of the song. And obviously I was like, oh man.
Bro, pre-kids, Jamie was down for anything.
I was down for anything by the way, I'm still down for anything if I have a babysitter.
Yeah, you just can't.
I just can't go. Okay.
As a doctor, just wanted to add that it isn't really normal practice to check the prostate of a child. Not to say the doctor was being malicious. Practice may have been different back then in the USA. I'm glad Jamie's neck is better, but I share Kassem's skepticism. There really isn't much evidence behind chiropractic. I hope you're all doing great and keep up the pod. Best wishes, Saqib. Thank you, Saqib.
Is that with a Q?
There is, yes. A Q in there.
Boom.
Everything comes full circle.
Yeah.
I bet he had a lot of teachers go do the...
Dude, if your name's Saqib, I know you know what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So, all right, I have a question. Cass, would you, I asked Jamie, but I want you to answer on here too, obviously, but would you want a virtual dog if you couldn't tell the difference? So let's say everything about it is just like your dog, but if you're going away, if you don't want him around, you can just shut it off, he goes, disappears.
Mm. Well, I gotta be honest, I kind of have that right now, you know, because my parents have taken my dog from me because they enjoy his company, they cook his food, they walk him. And I think it's good that they do some exercise. And so I'm kind of like the divorced dad where I go in and just pick up the dog for like the weekend and I take him home and then I bring him back and he spends most of the week over there. So I get kind of all the benefits of snuggling with my number one furball guy. And then I give him back and then they cook and they do all the hard work. They pick up his poop and...
he holds his poop all weekend until he goes back there.
That's right. He unloads a massive pile for them. And so, yeah, I think though, if I didn't have that, I would probably not take the virtual. I think there's part of the responsibility, the feeling like I'm being of service to another creature other than myself. That's humbling and important.
As you ditch him 80% of the week. Yeah, sure.
I consider it like one of those hospital dogs, you know, that go and takes
service
care of old
dogs.
People. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Service dogs. I think that's how I rationalize it. And I miss my guy.
Yeah.
Would you want?
No.
Virtual dog?
No, I like emotion.
I thought at the house you said yeah.
Well, I was like, yeah, I would have one, but like, Bean's also unpredictable. Like today, this morning, I took a picture of it out of nowhere. Bo was eating his breakfast, and he just hopped on, like, the bench. Like he just went up there.
That's very non-Bean of him.
Very non-Bean. Here, can you see? Like we have this little banquette, and he just jumped up, and we were all like, Bean, like, what was that? And it was kind of cute that it was like a very unpredictable moment.
Do you want food?
Yes.
We should. You got to send that picture to Gabby.
He's strange.
Please.
Bean is strange.
Bean is so weird.
That last Sunday where he drank all the grease, he was really all out of sorts that day. Yeah, he drank from a bucket of grease from the smoker. And really just was kind of all over the place. There was a lot of worry that there was going to be a monster diarrhea.
Correct.
Was there?
Cutter does the poop stuff, so I don't know.
We got to get the answer to that.
Yep.
We have to get the answer to that.
I don't do that shit no more.
Because, you know, bean, for me, like, I'm a big bean fan. when I used to go over and, like, go to bean, like, petting him was just another, like, I would be petting him and he would just lay there or whatever. And then we got a food delivery one time. And I didn't know that because Bean is so chill. I didn't realize that if you open the door when there's a delivery person, he will dart out and attack them.
Yeah.
He's crazy.
He doesn't like delivery people.
Yeah. So I went to open the door and I just thought Bean was like doing the thing he does, barking like when we come or whatever. And when I opened the door, he went to jet out and I had to grab him and like stop him from going out. And he looked up at me and went back in. Now, ever since then, whenever I go by him and like go to put my hand out, he instantly just rolls over.
Yeah, he's like, oh shit, you're an alpha.
He just shows me that belly. Too.
You dominated him.
Yep.
That's what Kassem does in the car, too. If I move my hand even a little bit, he just shows me that belly.
Yeah, I do that. I stuck my finger up Bean's butt, and ever since then, he rolls over whenever I walk by.
Oh, is that a thing you do to dominate someone, too?
No, it's just for fun.
Like if Kassem saw that doctor right now, Kassem would just instantly get on his back, roll over, and...
I haven't seen him since I was a kid, but if I saw him, I'd instantly recognize him, and I'd... spread my legs would go like, akimbo.
Remember this?
Yeah.
Remember this asshole you violated?
Being molested, huh? Where all my molests at? Send me a comment. Find me on Instagram. If you're watching this on YouTube, make sure you subscribe to us. Hit the notification bell. Our videos go live every Tuesday morning. And we're on Instagram. Jamie's on Instagram. I am on Instagram. Rob is kind of.
Yeah, he looks at PJ Pants.
He responds to most of the PJ Pants DMs on our rides home. So if you're looking to engage with us, that's a great way to do it, especially with Rob.
And also, our fans are great, but we do have like a thing that we've said getting like, is it 4 stars or 5 stars on iTunes? 5 stars.
Yeah, we want 5.
Well, 5, yeah, get 5 stars on iTunes. But I looked and our last rating was in November.
Oh, okay. Well, guys. We just haven't. I don't even remember the last time we mentioned it. So if you guys are on iTunes.
Yeah, come, please.
Just drop a little 5-star.
Dude, look, we hit some major milestones. We just hit 10,000 followers on Instagram. We're about to, we're closing in on 30K on YouTube. We have the most sponsors we've had in a while. We're doing well.
Sure.
Support. Thanks for the support. Is all I'm trying to say. And we have a subreddit, r/pajamapantspodcast. And we have a Twitter, pajamapantspod. And that's right. That's about it.
Yeah.
That's all she wrote.
Thanks,
guys. See you in the next one.